This is a copy of the DSM-4, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, 4th edition, published by the American Psychiatric Association. I have never seen a DSM-4 up until after my psychiatric experience, but I did know about it, and I did know that it was the mainstay of psychiatric treatment, in that it was the main book that psychiatry based its criteria on. In personality disorders, it has 10 different personality disorders. Paranoid personality disorder, which is a pattern of distrust and suspiciousness such that others' motives are interpreted as malevolent. Schizoid personality disorder, a pattern of detachment from social relationships and a restricted range of emotional expression. Schizotypal personality disorder is a pattern of acute discomfort in close relationships, cognitive or perceptual distortions, and eccentricities of behavior. Antisocial personality disorder. It's a pattern of disregard for and violation of the rights of others. Borderline personality disorder is a pattern of instability in interpersonal relationships, self-image, and affects, which is another word for mood, and a marked impulsivity. Histrionic personality disorder, which is a pattern of excessive emotionality and attention seeking, predictably usually diagnosed in women. Narcissistic personality disorder, which is a pattern of grandiosity, need for admiration, and lack of empathy. Avoidant personality disorder, which is a pattern of social inhibition, feelings of inadequacy, and hypersensitivity to negative evaluation. And dependent personality disorder, which is a pattern of submissive and clinging behavior related to an excessive need to be taken care of. And obsessive compulsive personality disorder, which is a pattern of preoccupation with orderliness, perfectionism, and control. If that doesn't include everybody, the DSM has also got personality disorder not otherwise specified. The thing that's extraordinary about these personality disorders is that they're deemed to be permanent, and no etiology is suggested for any of them. The DSM, in fact, early on in the piece, explains that it attempts to be neutral with respect to theories of etiology means that they don't have any theories of etiology other than genes or non-specific stresses, and these are repeated throughout the book. This includes schizophrenia, manic depression, attention deficit disorder extraordinarily, and the personality disorders are deemed to be based on something to do with early childhood, which is therefore permanent. Of course, they have drugs for the treatment of all of these conditions. And this is what I was objecting to in early 1995, when I started looking at psychiatry. Up till then, I had learned very little about psychiatry formally, although I had learned a lot about people through the experience of working as a general practitioner for 8 years. And also meeting many people as a musician and an artist in Melbourne. The problem with psychiatry is that it's all based on negative views of other people. And this is what I learned when I was in medical school in Queensland. Even though I didn't actually see a DSM, I learned psychiatry from the people who taught me psychiatry, who were the registrars and the consultants in the hospital. I learned the style of psychiatry that they practiced, which was to ignore people, deem them mad, and if they wouldn't take the drugs, know that they were mad. I studied in the University of Queensland and did my residency in general medicine, different terms, as well as surgery and pediatrics, and spent a year as pediatric registrar in the Royal Children's Hospital. During my term in psychiatry, I went and worked out at Rosemount Hospital, which was the psychiatric unit of the Royal Brisbane Hospital. There were a number of people in the locked ward, all of whom said that they were sane and wanted to go home. I, like all the other residents, avoided the locked ward. We didn't like it. It was a horrid place. The other people, if they accepted that they were mad, eventually they would get their tablets and leave hospital. The people who didn't accept that they were mad were kept in there pretty much until they accepted that they were mad. But I, of course, thought that they were mad, and therefore that's what should be done. And that's the same thing that nurses do. We learned how to view anybody who had psychic beliefs or beliefs different to ours, that it was a sign of their mental illness. Most people didn't need any convincing. They'd already been convinced that they had mental illnesses. When I started working as a general practitioner, I found little reason to label people as psychotic, because so many people have quite unusual, often incorrect or bizarre beliefs. This is there as a general phenomenon in society, and it's there from watching television and believing things that people see on television and reading books that give them all sorts of misinformation about their bodies, about their minds, and about the world. I did, however, find that many people were depressed, especially in the population that I treated, which was in a little mobile home village in the outskirts of Dandenong, where I had worked since 1988. In 1988, I came down from Queensland, and I came down in pursuit, rather than medicine, of music. And I had been actively interested in music since I was a child, when I learned piano and then guitar. After I graduated in 1983, I worked for 3 years in the hospital and then devoted myself full-time to the study of music and playing guitar and songwriting. This is what brought me down to Melbourne in 1988, and I started forming bands and songwriting and playing in bands in Melbourne. At the time, I also spent a lot of time reading about history, reading about geography, reading about things that I didn't learn when I was in medical school. I also worked in Willow Lodge, which was a mobile home village, where there were about 1,000 elderly people who had come from all walks of life and ended up in a mobile home in the outskirts of Dandenong, in the middle of an industrial estate near a sewerage plant and a whole lot of chemical factories. Most of them sat there watching television every night and worrying about their neighbors. And they were often on multiple drugs. They were on drugs for heart disease and diabetes and depression. Many of them were poorly educated about their health. In fact, almost all of them were poorly educated about their health, and many of them had been poorly treated within the public hospital system. I have a series of horror stories about my own experiences with the public hospital system in Melbourne. Patients who had gone in there with heart disease or heart attacks and come out with osteomyelitis in their spine from infected drips. People going in with gallbladder disease and coming out with the same problem, and then the problem being denied by the hospital. Numerous situations of negligence by the specialists in the public hospital system, with no possibility of redress or even acceptance that any mistake was made. There's widespread drug experimentation going on in the hospitals now. They're called drug trials, but the harmful effects of the drugs are not published. So even fatal side effects are often attributed to either suicide or heart attack.